Welcome to Alaska Weather, a production of Alaska Public Media and the National Weather Service, Alaska Region. Produced and broadcast daily from the studios of KAKM, Alaska Weather provides complete forecasts, public, marine, and aviation for all of Alaska. Alaska Weather is made possible by the following sponsors.
Inlet Tug and Barge, a marine transportation company specializing in harbor services focusing on the Port of Anchorage and the major commercial participants in the Cook Inlet region, providing customers with marine services specifically tailored to their needs.
The National Weather Service.
Good Wednesday, everyone. I'm meteorologist Dave Snyder with the National Weather Service. It's the 29th of April. As always, we encourage you to stay up to date with your local weather information from the Weather Service at weather.gov or using your VHF radio, marine radio, or NOAA weather radio to get your local forecast in that way. The weather info line at 800-472-0391 will take your call and help you find your forecast information that way. As always, you can find us on Facebook, on Twitter, and on YouTube in the afternoon. You'll get a sneak peek at what we're going to talk about here on Alaska Weather tonight. And then after the show, if you miss a piece, you can always go to alaskapublic.org and watch the entire show there. It'll be on the bottom right-hand side of their screen, or go to YouTube and in the search bar type in AKWXTV. The breakup map for April 29th just updated late this afternoon from the Alaska Pacific River Forecast Center. Monitoring Alaska's breakup is showing some open water there in the upper Tanana and the upper Nenana, as well as the upper Kuskokwim, but there is still mostly ice in most Alaska rivers at this point. The latest news is not showing any flooding concerns anywhere at this point. However, just yesterday we were watching some ice jam concerns around Salcha. That seems to be diminished at this point, and we continue to see more of a mush out in many area rivers. Now, here's how you can help. The Alaska breakup season is really monitored by you. Your reports to the Alaska Pacific River Forecast Center and the Department of Homeland Security and Emergency Management of Alaska work together to get information to communities and villages up and downstream when problems start to shape up. So when you see things that don't look right on your river, let us know. You can tweet that to us, share it with us on Facebook, or give us a call or email, and that information is useful to everyone up and down your river. So please participate there in the breakup season and help keep our entire Alaska community safe. Now, as far as the fire danger goes, things are drying out a little bit across the interior. We still have some higher fire danger north of the Alaska Range for parts of the Tanana Valley, and then south and west into the upper Kuskokwim Valley. There are some drier patches there. Now, some of the areas around south central have been relieved just a little bit, just enough to kind of erase that spot we had over the Matanuska Valley yesterday and previous days this weekend. So for now, we're still in the early parts of the season, but your fire-wise behavior is always a good thing to practice this early in the season and certainly going into the hotter and drier summers, especially in the interior. Looking out to the west, you can see low pressure hovering across the southern Bering Sea. It's pulling in clouds from east to west across the northern Bering Sea. We have warmer water lifting northward, and that is really chewing up a lot of the ice across the west. We'll talk about that in a little bit. In the meantime, the main storm superhighway is well to our south of Alaska, and that is steering a great amount of moisture well away from Alaska. But you can see there are some other trends that are working their way from west to east, a little bit further north, and closer to the Aleutian Chain. For the rest of Alaska, we see wave after wave coming in across the Gulf, and each one of these is just grazing that tip of that very wet flow coming in across the atmospheric superhighway we just saw right across the north and central Pacific. As some of that moisture makes it into southern parts of southeast, those waves bring not only rain, but also some gusty winds. And once again, across southern parts of southeast today, we saw gusts upwards of 30, 40, even maybe 50 miles per hour. Oh, well, most of the wettest weather is down across the southern parts of the panhandle. Some of that is making its way into the northern sections of Southeast, and this may fill in a little bit more tonight and in the coming days. So again, be prepared for really more of the same, as each one of these waves is falling apart as it crosses the Gulf, but each one of them is capable of producing wind and rain as it arrives. For South Central, a wide area of scattered showers continues across South Central, across the Matanuska and the Susitna Valleys, and around Prince William Sound. In fact, Prince William Sound had several waves of heavier rainfall working their way from southeast to northwest earlier today. As we look a little bit further north into the Yukon Valley, conditions are still fairly dry there. A lot of the cloud cover seems to be missing you, but just to the east of the Alcan, plenty of clouds remain there, and some of those have been bubbling up. In previous days, we saw a few showers and thunderstorms there. Not a whole lot of that seemed to be making its way westward just yet, but the season is young, of course. Out across the Bering Sea, we're still watching our north and easterly flow bring cloud cover to the Kotzebue Sound region, as well as the Seward Peninsula and areas in the northern Bering Sea coast. There is a fog we're seeing across the north slope this afternoon, and that layer of fog will move north and south depending on how strong high pressure is. That's located way out across the Chukchi Sea coast. As that shifts a little bit further westward, expect the fog to continue across the north slope with spotty areas of snow showers tonight. Look for scattered areas of light snow showers across the southern Alcan border, maybe into the Copper River Basin. A much better chance, though, that we'll be dealing with rain showers for more places along the highways and the road systems. And look for scattered areas of rain and snow showers, perhaps above about 2,500 to 3,000 feet. Across southeast, there's an opportunity for a few thunderstorms, mainly offshore of the southern coast. Out across the open Gulf, look for areas of light rain. Some of that will certainly reach Kodiak Island, as well as the Alaska Peninsula. And pockets of rain and snow showers should continue across south and western parts of the Bering Sea, as well as the central Aleutians. Going into Thursday, you can see the overall shift of these low-pressure circulations moving a little bit further eastward. What that means for you? Well, more of the same if you're in southeast. A better chance for some light rain there for the central and southern parts of southeast. Probably a heavier chance of rain for areas around the Dixon entrance, including Craig and Klawock. North of the Alaska Range, we've got just enough cold air to mix up a little rain and snow there for any showers that develop, but most likely for most places along the Parks and the Richardson, as well as the Glen, we're probably talking about some showers of rain there all the way down the Seward Highway and into Kodiak Island. The Alaska Peninsula, more rain showers than anything else. However, just offshore and northward, even into the Pribilofs, you're looking at rain and snow showers there. The west, more unsettled weather for you, with low pressure park to the west and south of St. Matthew. Areas of fog around the north slope, a better chance for snow showers if you're from Kaktovik, south and west of Prudhoe Bay and Deadhorse. And then much sunnier and drier weather for areas around the Seward Peninsula, Norton Sound, and the middle Yukon Valley. For Friday, a low pressure shifts northward just a little bit. That should take the focus for showers a little bit further northward as well into the Yukon Valley. Showers may break up a little bit more across South Central, but they're not gone entirely. And for Southeast, well, more rain for you. Although the wave of low pressure has moved eastward just a little bit, we still have kind of a weak trough here or a disturbance that is capable of keeping that onshore flow going. So we'll keep light rainfall in your forecast for Friday. Showers continue for the Alaska Peninsula as well west as Unalaska and Dutch Harbor and Nikolsky. Out to the west, though, you can see a ridge of high pressure working in over Adak and Atka. You might get a break at the sunshine there. And then to the west, the sunshine will quickly come to an end as you see a new weather system is working in towards Shemya and Attu, as well as areas closer to Kiska by the end of the week. Temperatures today, pleasantly mild in southeast, but the clouds cut back on some of the heat you enjoyed just a few days ago. Mid to upper 40s for many there, around Juneau, 45, 47 in Sitka, Ketchikan and Annette in the mid to upper 40s, 48 around Hyder. Wrangell, Craig, Klawock, all enjoying temperatures in the mid-40s this afternoon. Prince William Sound a little bit cooler today as well. Lower to mid-40s from Valdez to Cordova to Seward at 48, 54 in Homer, 48 in Kenai, 51 in Anchorage around 3 o'clock. Around Talkeetna, it was 43 degrees up the road and got close to 50 degrees around Healy, 52 in Fairbanks with upper 40s for Northway and Eagle. Fort Greeley was 51, Fort Yukon 43 degrees, with areas even further north still in the teens, 20s, and 30s. Arctic Village only hit 30 degrees this afternoon, 16 in Anaktuvik Pass, teens and 20s for the north slope. Atkasuk, you were 22, Kaktovik 20 degrees, Barrow 22. Around the Kotzebue Sound region, a few places made it above freezing, including Kivalina at 35, Kotzebue was only 23, Tin City on the western tip of the peninsula at 19, 36 in Nome, 27 in St. Lawrence Island, 52 in McGrath. Most of the YK Delta saw temperatures inland in the mid to upper 50s, but right along the coast, temperatures were considerably cooler and just above freezing there for the YK Delta. For Bristol Bay, Dillingham and King Salmon both made it into the 50s today. Kodiak Island also saw temperatures ranging from 44 to 48 degrees around Kodiak itself. Lower to mid 40s for many along the Alaska Peninsula, though Sand Point was pleasantly warmer at 50 degrees, mid to upper 30s for the Pribilofs, and 30s and 40s for the Western and Central Chain. Now, overnight low temperatures will remain above freezing for many in the Tanana Valley and points eastward. As we head south and west into the Kuskokwim and lower Yukon valleys, look for temperatures there to also remain above 32. Teens and 20s for most along the south-facing slopes of the Brooks Range, and sub-freezing, of course, for the Arctic coast, anywhere from 11 to about 15, maybe even 16 degrees around Kaktovik out toward Wainwright. 26 in Nome, southeast, looking at temps in the 30s and 40s tonight. 40 in Kodiak and 30s for the chain, with high temperatures tomorrow in the lower 40s there. 37 in St. Paul, 56 in Bethel tomorrow, south central, looking at temperatures that are probably warmer again than today, lower to mid 50s for many. Looks like the middle Tanana Valley and areas around Fairbanks in the mid 50s, 48 in Fort Yukon, 53 in Tanana. And southeast, looking at temperatures holding close to, if not just a hair below, the 50 degree mark for your Thursday. Now on to flying weather. As I said, showers and thunderstorms may be possible for some of the marine areas just offshore of the southern coastline of southeast. Look for IFR conditions to be possible mainly along the intercoast and into the higher terrain. That could include places like Ketchikan, Annette, and certainly Hyder there. Most areas will be, at worst, MVFR, and you'll see some of that around the Chilkoot and White Pass as well. The north slopes, looking at IFR conditions from Kaktovik as far west to Prudhoe Bay and Deadhorse, and then southward toward the north-facing slopes of the Brooks Range. And then conditions should improve a little bit there from Wainwright westward into the Chukchi Sea. IFR conditions north of the Bering Strait and into Kotzebue Sound, across St. Lawrence Island, and into the Pribilofs and the north-facing coast of the Alaska Peninsula. Places like Port Hyden and maybe Pilot Point will be impacted there. Here's your pass conditions then as you look out across the Alaska Range and northward, Anaktuvik Pass, IFR trending toward MVFR conditions. You'll see the worst visibility on the north-facing slopes there, and especially the further north you go. Conditions may worsen a little bit as you get away from some of the higher terrain. Lake Clark and Merrill Pass will likely see improving conditions during the day. VFR likely by the afternoon. And Rainy Pass, we expect VFR through most of your Thursday. The same goes for Windy Pass and Isabel Pass. Visual flight rule there. Mentasta Pass, we expect VFR conditions there. Tanita Pass, we'll say VFR through most of the day. Portage Pass looks pretty good, though watch out for showers to develop, especially in the afternoon. And Chilkoot and White Pass may hover near MVFR conditions, but again, further southward, especially in southern southeast, IFR conditions could linger through a good part of the day. Tomorrow morning's freezing levels show the warm weather trying to lift northward, and we have a big chunk of that across the eastern Gulf. This is also helping to encourage more rain and showers across the coastline. We also have a broad area of warmer air situated across the middle Yukon Valley and the southwestern coast. Some of those freezing levels as high as 4,000 feet right over Bethel. No wonder it's warm there. The surface freezing line is also now north of the Pribilofs, and with that, again, comes more erosion of the ice. The icing potential tomorrow will linger above 2,000 feet across the western Bering. We'll watch for some light icing potential, mainly across the Susitna and Matanuska Valley and westward along the Alaska Range. And then out across the Gulf, levels as high as 4,000 to 6,000 feet for some light icing threats there. Most of that, again, fairly scattered and not concentrated in any one place during the day. The jet stream shows that super highway of weather south of Alaska. You can see those wind speeds coming in from the west and southwest around 105 knots and working their way into western Canada. High pressure sitting across the north slope is holding back a lot of the weather, keeping things fairly stable there and also creating that cold dome of air across the north slope. The main track of the weather is still out across the central Pacific and well away from Alaska at this point. At 9,000 feet, we have several waves of low pressure. These are disturbances capable of stirring up more rain, showers, and maybe even occasionally a thunderstorm. But the main track of the weather, again, is just south of most of the mainland. That leaves the interior with fairly light winds, some of those blowing from many different directions, anywhere from 5 to about 10 knots. But you can see high pressures guiding in more of a northerly flow down most of the west coast, and then guiding that back out over the Bering anywhere from the east and southeast, still around 10 knots. We have stronger winds, though, across the Dixon entrance. Watch for that. That will create some turbulence threats. The winds up to about 40 knots there. A little bit stronger across the central and eastern chain as well, but only around 30 knots for tomorrow. At 3,000 feet, the winds are greatly diminished at this level for southern southeast, so you'll have to climb up a little bit higher to find that chop. Look for very light winds and maybe even erratic winds across the interior, very variable throughout the day, and winds guiding in from the east and northeast along the north slope, and the west coast. A little bit of a lighter flow as well across the central and eastern chain. So what about turbulence? Well, we're going to limit that mainly to the central and eastern Gulf for tomorrow. Light to isolated, moderate across the central and southern parts of southeast, mainly due to the circulation and that disturbance working through the region, as well as those faster winds that we saw around 9,000 feet. So watch for some chop there, if not a little bit of occasional moderate. Otherwise, flying should be pretty good. Just dodge the showers and enjoy the weather wherever you're going. That's a look at your aviation forecast. We'll be back with a look at the sea ice edge and your marine weather here in just a few minutes. Stay tuned. Good evening, and thanks for joining us for another edition of Alaska Weather Facts. I'm meteorologist Dave Snyder, joined again by Eric Stevens of GINA, the Geographic Information Network of Alaska, from the University of Alaska Fairbanks. And Eric, thanks so much for joining us again tonight.
Happy to be here, Dave.
Thanks, Eric. And we've been talking about the complex gathering of information from satellites, looking down on the surface of the planet, and some of those orbits around the planet work for Alaska, and some of them don't. There's a lot of challenges with those. How can we get better imagery for the poles and specifically for Alaska?
Right. Well, today we're going to talk about a very interesting kind of satellite orbit that has potential to be real helpful for the high latitudes.
Okay.
Especially us here in Alaska, Canadians, Russians, Norwegians will all be interested in this. The satellites are not in orbit yet. Now the future is uncertain, but it's possible, and if this happens, it will be wonderful for Alaska.
Okay.
It's called the highly elliptical orbit.
Oh, that sounds
it's interesting. Yeah. And okay. I think first to help our discussion, we should get back to some of Kepler's laws and how do satellites work.
Sure.
Kepler's first law, an orbit of a planet around a sun or a weather satellite around the Earth is not necessarily a circle, it's an ellipse.
Okay.
And the highly elliptical orbit takes advantage of this aspect. We're going to put the Earth in one of the ellipse and then stretch one of the foci of the ellipse and then stretch that ellipse out real far to make it highly elliptical.
And the foci is that bend part of the end of the ellipse. If you're going to stretch out a rubber band, that would be the center, kind of the stretchy part. The
yes.
End. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And then Kepler's second law says that the closer something is to the thing that it's orbiting, the faster it goes.
Okay.
We see this in the solar system, that Mercury flies around the sun real fast. Jupiter, much slower. Jupiter's further away, it's slower. Mercury's closer in, it's faster. This happens with weather satellites, too. Even satellites like the International Space Station, it's pretty close to the Earth. It goes around the Earth in only 90 minutes.
Okay.
That thing is moving.
Fast.
It's only 250 miles away. So how can we take advantage of these two aspects of Kepler's laws of motion to get better weather surveillance of Alaska? And this highly elliptical orbit is going to be the approach. So we have with us today our friendly planet Earth and our simulated satellite, the lid off of this salt shaker
like
here.
Sputnik there. Yeah.
Here it is. It's shiny, it's metal, it's space worthy. And what we want to be able to do is, could you have a satellite hover over the top of the world, up over Alaska? You can't really do that. Geostationary satellites have to be over the equator.
Okay.
So how could we almost solve this? And this is the tricky part. Maybe should we tilt the Earth
tilt
over?
The other, focus on the pole, that's what we're trying to accomplish here, right?
So here we have the northern side of the planet, and we're going to trace out the orbit of a satellite with this salt shaker lid here. Now imagine a highly elliptical orbit. So let's put the Earth in one of the foci of the ellipse, and we'll have an imaginary foci out here.
Okay.
So the satellite will not go in a circle around the Earth, but will be in this long strung out ellipse.
Okay.
So the satellite will go
kind of like a racetrack.
Yes, there you go, like a racetrack.
Okay.
So it's an oval elliptical shape like that. And notice now that when the satellite's over here, we've got a nice view of the northern hemisphere
kind of
around. There's
down.
Alaska, Russia, Canada, Greenland, all there. So that's the ellipse aspect of an orbit, Kepler's first law. The second law saying that when you're further away as a satellite, you go slower.
Oh.
And this we can take real advantage of. Because the way this orbit works, when the satellite goes over Antarctica here, it's going to be close to the Earth.
Okay.
It's going to be moving, whoosh, goes on by. And then as it comes out here, it will slow down. This increases what is known as the dwell time. The satellite will just hang here looking for hours at Alaska and the high Arctic. And then eventually it will come around and it will accelerate and whiz around the South Pole and then come back and hang here for a while because it's further away from the planet. It goes slower. Yeah. It has to. That's the laws of motion. And such like that, repeating.
Wow.
Now, the real important way to make this work is you have to have two satellites. Okay. So that while one is whipping around the pole, you've got the other one out here. And they work as a team. You could then get a series of images of Alaska that can be almost from a quasi, a constant frame of reference.
Right.
And you can loop them together to make movies. You can take a picture every 10 minutes, say, of Alaska, and then loop it, playing it at several frames a second. You could see the clouds whiz on by. You know, the Weather Channel, weather broadcasters in the lower 48 especially, can show these movie loops from the geostationary satellites. In Alaska, we've never really been able to do that very well, especially in the higher, most northern parts of the state, because those geostationary satellites are over the equator. It's not a good view. And this highly elliptical orbit, whipping around the South Pole and then dwelling up here, would be a way for us to get that constant frame of reference and do really good weather surveillance over the Arctic, seeing where those storms are, where they're going. Right. Nothing quite like a movie loop of the weather in time to really illustrate what's important, what's going on.
And compared to what we have right now, we just have small windows or snapshots of what's going on with the polar orbiters. We don't have that long range view that's looking top down to give us that complete motion picture that helps us understand so much of the atmosphere at this
There's
point.
So many different kinds of satellites. Each has their advantage. Each is important, and the highly elliptical orbit satellite will also fit into that scheme. It's a nifty idea to solve an Alaskan challenge.
That's fantastic. Well, that sounds really exciting. And again, a kind of a satellite dream of the future to come. Okay, very good. Thanks for joining us today, Eric. We really appreciate the information. And if you'd like to learn more about what Eric does at GENA, the University of Alaska Fairbanks, we invite you to visit the web address that you see on your screen there. For Alaska Weather Facts, I'm meteorologist Dave Snyder. Thanks, Eric and other Dave. Here's a look at the sea ice edge. And if you haven't checked this out in a while, obviously there are some big changes developing around St. Lawrence Island and southward. Polynya in many respects there, a lot of open water, but also still some ice in those open areas. So watch for that. But you can see the leading edge of ice, at least the southern extent, is lifting northward there. There's still some broken off strips that are dropping southward, but a lot of this again is moving into warmer water, so it doesn't last very long as it's drifting southward. So the sea ice is on the move, especially northward as we head into springtime. Here's a look at southeast, and you can see those south and easterly winds across the intercoastal waterways, 10, 15, even 25 knots as you get into Clarence Strait, up to 8-foot seas in the south, 2-foot seas for the Lynn Canal. Southwesterlies across the southern outer coast, up to 25 knots with 11 to 12-foot seas. We did have some stronger winds in the region today, so watch for maybe some isolated areas of stronger winds during the day. And again, check the forecast in the morning before you head out. Easterlies coming out across Sound, 10 to 15 knots with a 7 to 8-foot sea in the north. And as we get into Friday, you'll notice the wind switched the other way. The disturbance moves into the inner coast. And with that, a west and southwesterly wind follows suit. 10 to 20 knots there with the strongest winds outside of Dixon Entrance. Southeasterlies for Ketchikan, Metlakatla, and northward with 20-knot winds with a 4-foot sea. 10 to 20-knot winds northward as well into the Lynn Canal. Those winds come up to 20 knots from the south. Across south central, light northeasterly winds inside of Prince William Sound. On the outside, it's an easterly flow outside in the northern Gulf at 20 knots with a 6-foot sea. Northeasterly is coming down the Kenai Peninsula coastline for Cook Inlet. We're looking at southwesterly winds only 10 to 15 knots. A variable flow west of the Barrens that becomes northeasterly inside of Shelikof Strait, and northwesterly winds east of Kodiak Island at 20 knots with a 9-foot sea. More of a broad west and southwesterly flow developing as we head into Friday. Those winds around 10 to 15 knots in most areas. A little bit stronger outside of Prince William Sound, up to 25 knots there with a 6-foot sea. Variable winds inside of Prince William Sound and across the northern Cook Inlet. The winds only at 10 knots with a 2-foot sea. For the Alaska Peninsula, south and westerly winds for the Bristol Bay region and southward along the Alaska Peninsula Bering Sea coast at 15 knots with a 5-foot sea. For the Pacific coast, 20-knot winds with 9 to 10-foot seas from the west and northwest. As we get into Friday, the northwesterlies west of Castle Cape will stay around 15 knots or so with a 7-foot sea extending down the coastline for Sandpoint and King Cove. Variable flow up to 10 knots there north of Cold Bay and across the Bering Sea coast. We'll get more of a southwesterly flow as we get into Bristol Bay with a 3-foot sea expected for Friday. For the Aleutians, westerlies sweep across the entire chain, 15 to 20 knots or so. A few areas from Adak to Kiska may see winds as strong as 25 knots with a 6-foot sea, 7 to 9-foot seas on the Pacific coast, and 6 to 7-foot seas on the Bering Sea coast for Thursday. For Friday, southerlies take over from Kiska to Attu, 35 knots with a 9-foot sea. East of that, we're still dealing with lighter winds, generally 10 to 15 knots. A little bit stronger wind flow, though, from Adak to Kiska again. And again, wrapping back into that southerly flow we just saw in the west. As we get into the west coast, northerlies are coming down from St. Lawrence Island through Hooper Bay and north of Nunivak Island. We'll have some open water there, as you just saw, south of St. Lawrence Island, with 3-foot seas expected in the open areas. A northeasterly flow around St. Matthew. Variable winds around the Pribilofs, 10-foot seas with a 10-knot winds with a 4-foot sea, and westerlies coming into the upper Kuskokwim, looking at 15 knots with a 5-foot sea. Southwesterlies then into Kuskokwim Bay as we head into Friday. 10 to 15-knot winds north of Nunivak Island, still looking at a northerly flow crossing St. Lawrence Island with a 2-foot sea. And southwesterlies are expected for the Pribilofs with a 15-knot wind and 4-foot seas. For the north slope, north and easterly winds coming through the Beaufort and down the Chukchi Sea coast. A little bit stronger there, 20 to 25-knot winds for Thursday. By Friday, winds diminish in all areas there, 15 to 20 knots, looking more of an east to westerly flow across Barrow and the north slope, and northeasterlies for the Beaufort seacoast, 15 knot winds outside of Kotzebue Sound coming in from the north on Friday. That's a look at your marine weather. Let's recap what's going on in your part of Alaska tonight. Low pressure sitting across the central and southern parts of southeast will keep rain and wind going for many, from Ketchikan to Craig and Klawock. And that included, and a few thunderstorms will be possible, mainly offshore of the outer coast. We'll look for another wave of low pressure to follow that as we get into Thursday and Friday, and we'll probably see another one set up as we head into the weekend. That's just going to reinforce that wetting flow coming in from the west and southwest, and at times might stir up the wind and maybe even a thunderstorm or two generally out to sea. Across south central, unsettled weather will continue. Look for periods of showers there above 2,500 to about 3,000 feet. You may see some of that mix in with or change over to snow. Most places along the road system will be dealing with wet weather, though. As you get into areas north and east of the Alaska Range, closer to the Alcan, you'll have a better chance of seeing some of that snow in the morning, becoming rainfall in the afternoon. Snow showers for the north slope as well as the eastern Brooks Range. More likely than not, you'll be dealing with fog as your main weather issue. And across the west coast, look for periods of scattered rain and snow showers, especially along the Alaska Peninsula. I'm meteorologist Dave Snyder. Thanks for watching.
These forecasts are to be used for planning purposes only. Call 1-800-WX-BRIEF for a formal pre-flight briefing. Always file a flight plan before you go flying. The U.S. Coast Guard Auxiliary urges you to leave a float plan with a friend or the harbor master before you go boating. Alaska Weather is made possible by the following sponsors.
The National Weather Service.